For me, Sajjad Lone, I was a friend of his father. And there also I had prepared the constitution for the People's Conference Party. The constitution, I had drafted it. Yeah. I contested the elections on the basis of which the People's Conference was registered and then recognized as a political party. So PC has been like a home to me.
True.
So for me, Sajjad Lone is like a son. So if Sajjad Lone is interested
in that is my question. Has he spoken to you?
Well, he is not directly spoken to me.
But so you are being saying if Sajjad Lone is interested, then he interrupted you.
Pardon me?
You are saying if Sajjad Lone is interested, Mufti actually interrupted you. Can you complete that?
Can you complete the sentence? Sajjad Lone.
You are saying if Sajjad Lone is interested.
If he is interested, that there should be a third force that should emerge.
And you will be leading it?
That could be considered. Should be considered. It should be encouraged. Mm-hmm. Should be encouraged. Because people are looking for something. Mm-hmm. Something new. Something different.
So should we then say Muzaffar Beigh has announced to be part of the new front and move out of...
I prefaced it by saying I will see what the reaction of the leadership of BJP is. Decided to speak out my mind after a long spell of silence. I have not spoken with press for about 1 year now, roughly 1 year. During this time, some developments have taken place which prompt me to speak out my mind or remain silent forever. I have decided not to remain silent but to speak out. What prompted me most of all was the decision of the National Conference to boycott local elections. The panchayat elections and the municipality elections are the basis of a democracy. And these are the elections where public is mobilized more than in assembly elections or parliamentary elections. What were the reasons for NC to call for a boycott? The real reason may be something else. But the ostensible stated reason given out by National Conference was that Government of India must clarify its Article 35A of the Constitution, which is a matter sub judice in the Supreme Court. Now that logic is flawed because the issue of Article 35A is not to be decided by politicians or by Government of India. It is to be decided by the highest court of the land, which is not afraid of taking bold decisions. In the Temple case in the South, we have seen how boldly the Supreme Court has given its verdict. Now, the logic is also flawed because suppose this case takes 5 years to be decided by the Supreme Court, like Ram Mandir case has been pending in the Supreme Court for so many, many long years. Will NC, which was followed by somewhat lamely by PDP, will these parties boycott even the assembly elections or the elections to the parliament? What is the justification for a political party to exist if it does not contest elections, does not involve the people, does not do the groundwork at the root basis? You must have noticed that in certain areas, people, despite the boycott call by NC followed by PDP, have voted. And the basic development at the grassroots level is only possible if the representatives of the people are elected and they take a decision, day-to-day decision, as well as long-term decisions at the ground level. Now, I know the reason why NC called for a boycott. It was a defensive step that they took because of certain statements that its senior leader had made somewhere in Delhi. To overcome the resentment, they decided to call for the boycott of the elections. Why did PDP follow NC? I do not understand, except that perhaps they lamely and unwittingly fell into a trap. We had founded PDP, I had prepared the basic document, the vision document of PDP, Mufti Saab was the leader. We had formed PDP to find a middle ground in the political space of Jammu and Kashmir. On the one side, there was a long history of NC playing on both sides of the fence. Whenever they were in power, Delhi was fine. Whenever they were out of power, Delhi was an enemy. It's a 70 years old history of NC. I personally hold both the leaders, top leaders of NC, in great regard and affection. But I am sorry to say that they do not find enough courage and conviction to take one line instead of playing on both sides of the fence. I think people of Jammu and Kashmir, particularly in Kashmir, which is the troubled area, deserve plain speaking. They have a right for plain speaking. Because of the mistakes committed in the past, particularly in 1987, militancy took roots in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. In 1987, there was an alliance between NC and Congress. What did they do? Yusuf Shah was a teacher. He contested election from Amira Kadal and he won the election. His agent was Yasir Malik, election agent. What did the government do? They arrested Yusuf Shah, took him to, I think, Kotibagh police station, which is near Iqbal Park. That's called Kotibagh. Is it? The Sheikh, Shergari police station, and they arrested his wife. They arrested his principal election agent, Yasir Malik, who was very young those days. And they arrested his minor sister. They had to spend the night over there in a police station. And if some of you recall, an interview was published in India Today by Mr. Badwar, who was then the editor of India Today, in which he had interviewed Yasir Malik at the house of late Ubil Ghani Lone. And Yasir Malik had declared that he will go to Pakistan and bring weapons and fight the Indian state with those weapons. That's exactly what happened. So the mistakes of the past, this double speak, cheap electoral benefits. What would have happened in 1987? If 1987 would not have taken place, perhaps there would have been no militancy in Kashmir. Would everything have been fine? No, everything would not have been fine. But we would not see terror and killings of young people. No matter who gets killed, whether it is our young boys or whether they are Indian soldiers, their families suffer. The society suffers. I think without being harsh, our politicians in the past, by playing on both sides of the fence, are responsible for the militancy and killing of our young men as well as the young men from outside the state who are involved in security operations. Unfortunately, PDP took this decision to boycott even without consulting me. I was in Delhi. I was one phone call away. They did not consult me. I remained quiet because I did not want this PDP to fall asunder, because after Mukti Seed I was the president of PDP, and since I had done most of the paperwork, the intellectual work for the party, the political agenda, and 95% of the resolutions passed by PDP were drafted by me. Therefore, I did not want to speak out and cause any fissures in the party. But today, PDP is in peril. Sometimes there are talks of, you know, NC-PDP alliance. The very basis for which PDP was founded was to do away with the family rule of a particular prevalent in NC. That was the basic reason. We wanted democracy. We wanted a middle ground where the people of Kashmir feel secure and safe and honored in India. And at the same time, the Kashmir problem is resolved through negotiation in terms of Shimla agreement. That was the basic purpose of PDP. Now these ideas, suppose there is an alliance between NC and PDP. How will Jammu react? It will be an all-Muslim alliance. How will the people of Ladakh react? These kind of irresponsible talks will only lead to the trifurcation of the state. Ladakh will not remain with as a part of Jammu and Kashmir. And Jammu would also not like to remain a part of a state which is ruled only by one community, no matter what the religion of that community is. Unfortunately, these small mistakes in the long run lead to consequences which are horrendous and which may be injurious to the interests of the very people that these parties propagate to protect. I think that is the main grounds that I have against this, the decisions taken by both by LC and especially PDP, because PDP has sort of betrayed its workers and it has betrayed its own MLAs by throwing them to the winds, depriving them of an opportunity to connect with the people, and the space has been occupied. Political space does not permit any vacuum. The space will be occupied by one force or the other. Politics does not wait for people who boycott elections. Sheikh Saab had boycotted elections. Plebiscite had, front had boycotted elections. What was the result? The result was an election engineered from Delhi in favor of Congress. And finally, when Sheikh Saab realized that by disconnecting with the people and through boycott, he had lost the public support, he decided to come back to the mainstream. And he remained loyal to the constitution under which he had taken an oath of office. Today's newspaper says that we need another Sheikh Abdullah. Sheikh Abdullahs are not born, every day. People like him are born once in a while. We should have learned from the slips and unwitting errors that he might have committed during his long illustrious career. But it appears that neither NC nor PDP has learned any lesson from the illustrious and honorable life of Sheikh Muhammad Abdullah. In fact, PDP has not lived up to the expectations of Mufti Sahab. Mufti Sahab was a strong believer in Hindu-Muslim unity, integrity of the state, and the alliance with BJP. Initially, I was consulted about it for one day only, just for one day. And I told him that this alliance will work only if there is a meeting of minds, because it is not easy to form an alliance between a regional party, which has its regional aspirations, and BJP, which has a certain background. Unless there is meeting of minds, this alliance will not succeed, and we won't be able to sell it to the people. I was of the opinion that if PDP and BJP seriously and sincerely work together, it will be a model for the nation, where Muslims will feel secure that they can be safe even if BJP is in power. But we failed to form a real alliance with BJP. The two parties remained aloof. The ministers were not even intermingling with each other. They were not even connected with each other. There was a coordination committee of which I was the chairman. Only one meeting was held. After that, there was no coordination meeting at all. Perhaps because I was the chairman of the coordination committee. Perhaps I was required to contest parliamentary elections so that I am out of the state. Perhaps that is equally true in case of Tariq Kara Sahab. Now, but one thing I am clear about, that Mufti Sahab's vision of alliance was not what it turned out to be. It was not implemented on the ground. Secondly, why I am disturbed about the situation in PDP is that during the 2 years and some months that it was in power, it failed on the delivery front. It did not deliver on any of its promises. There was development deficit. Funds were either unutilized or that they were not even received from the central government, because no projects were submitted to the central government. The government of India does not give funds unless there is a proper submission of projects and the purposes for which the funds will be utilized. We had promised employment to the youth. My heart goes out to the young people, PhD people, with degrees of PhD, who are unemployed. There was no concrete step, not a single step was taken to open up the space or opportunities for the employment of the young boys and girls that we have. Kashmiris, and I include even from people from Jammu, are very intelligent people. They are one of the most intelligent people in the country. They are highly educated. They are motivated. But they feel disillusioned today. They have lost faith in the mainstream. In fact, some of them have lost faith even in Hurriyat Conference. That's why they have taken an extreme position. Hurriyat Conference had not ever spoken for a Khilafat movement or establishing a Khilafat system in Jammu and Kashmir. But there are some young men who want to go back to history and establish a centrally monitored Khilafat movement somewhere from the Arab countries, you know, the leadership should emerge, and we here in India or Pakistan should follow it. I am not anti-young people. In fact, when I was their age, I went to prison 5 times. I was detained under Defense of India rules because I refused to welcome Ghulam Ahmad Sadiq when he was the chief minister and I was the president of the students' union in Baramulla, because he had come through back door.